Well, hello, everybody. I'm Carleen McKay from New Workforce Hawaii. We're delighted to be with you once again, and we're going to give you some thought today about why we are different and what you need that's different from the past in terms of how you ran your career. Welcome to you, Rob Kinslow.
Hi. Nice to be here, Carleen. Thank you.
Good. So let's talk about reframing just for a minute or two, and then we'll come back to you and talk about how we do it. We looked at the world probably 10 years ago and saw a couple of big differentiators way back then. One was the longer lifetimes. And so now we have a challenge, which is to work later in life and to continue to earn and to contribute. We have a challenge on the public sector in that our pensions are already woefully underfunded. So there's a problem there because we're going to run out of pension money, what's left of it. We have a problem in the private in that we all want to remain independent and keep going. So we looked at this and said, what can we do to help people sustain themselves? And in a minute, I'll have you talk with Rob about his background in sustainability and how that brought him to us. Then we looked at technology and said, what's so different about today? And you see it every day. So I want you paying attention to what you're seeing. You've seen, not here necessarily, but everywhere, Macy's, Penny's, Kohl's, all the different big retail stores changing how they sell, what they sell, where they sell. What does this mean for people who work in those stores? What does it mean for you as how you're going to buy? All of these things are interchangeable, and you cannot get away from the fact that we are reframing ourselves as we sit here today from the past to the future. And I need to add 30 seconds just because I always talk about Steve Jobs, who was one of my heroes. In 1976, I think, is when he founded Apple. The world changed then, but it's taken till now for people to really get it, because that's how change is. It's subtle, moves slowly, and then all of a sudden it's on this kind of fast track to the future. That's where we are. So that's a start. Why are we working with you to help you reframe? We want you to be able to continue to earn, to continue to learn, to continue to contribute, to continue to have a good life that you deserve if you earn it. What do you think, Rob?
Well, that's why I have joined with you, to help educate people and coach people in how the new workforce will meet the needs of the emerging markets that are out there today. Because markets are changing rapidly, as we can see in the United States over the last 30 years. Unemployment went really high. Employment and jobs were offshored. And today we're in a place where we're retrenching, and our workers are going to have to be reframing, because Robbie is here, Robbie Robot. Technology is moving much faster than our social systems can even keep up. And so this reframing that we're talking about today is a metaphor, or is a strategy for moving beyond the workforce that we had of yesterday into the workforce of tomorrow. And that's what I hope we'll be talking about today, is our strategic process that we have as a New Workforce Hawaii. That's why we're in Hawaii here, is to help people understand what's coming in the new workforce, and to give them tools, and to give them a plan, a strategy, a process for delivering the future to themselves and their families.
Well, let's do that. I think it's important to demonstrate what we do versus just declare.
Yeah, exactly.
So when we talk about change, we look at older, longer lifetimes. We look at children who are maybe not getting the educations they need for the future, one way or the other. We look at the fact that the robots are here and taking over a lot of the blue-collar work that used to be done. What are we doing about it? In our case, with New Workforce Hawaii, we've developed a strategy that takes threat to opportunity. And I think that's the key. If you would listen to only two things, one would be changing threats to opportunity, and the second would be ingrain in your mind that your career is your business, not your job. Yeah. Jobs are one way of working, oftentimes some part of our careers.
Yeah.
But your career itself is your business. So let's use a demo. Let's look at the strategic planning process, which is our core underlying process to help people understand how to manage the change. So you want to start?
Well, the New Workforce Hawaii is a hui of experts who help you help people who come to us, institutions, individuals, organizations, train their people for the new workforce. So the first step in the strategic process, and we can put that up there now, is really letting go of your expectations that the past is somehow going to continue into the future, that the future is going to look like the past. And that often is the hardest part of this process for people who have had a career that has been maybe a series of 2 to 3 jobs, and letting go of the desire for the future to be like the past. And so tell me more a little bit about what you've experienced with people in your letting go part of this step.
Well, as you know, I at one time was a vice president of a major outplacement firm, and we primarily outplaced very senior people in that firm. And so they'd come in with their high salaries and expect to find the next job with another high salary. And increasingly, that wasn't there for them. Mm. So what were they to do? They usually had high cost of living, live in Hawaii, live in other parts of the world where you've already said you've got that underlying cost.
Families, cars, houses,
all
expenses.
All of this stuff, right. So that's where I started. But then where I am today that I'm really intrigued by is working with the high school and college students. Mm. And the reason is that I think absolutely that they have something to let go of too. Older people let go of the past. I just need one more job, Carleen. Yeah. That's what one more job. Yeah. That's all I need, one more job. I have so many anecdotal stories, and I love storytelling, so I'll tell you one day. But the kids come in with $30,000, $40,000, $100,000 in college debt, preparing themselves for work that may not be there. And what they have to let go of is just seeing the world as it was.
Yeah.
How much time does it take somebody to let go? I don't know, Rob, you tell me. You're one of those that let go.
Yeah. Well, I have to say that, you know, as an engineer on a major engineering firm working on some of the most advanced technology in the military, it took me several years to let go, and I still have not let go. I went back to school and got a master's in sustainable development, hoping that I could move into that next phase of what humans are experiencing with respect to climate change and how we're going to live together with 9 billion on the planet. And so letting go is, I think, a process that continues throughout this whole 8-step process that we're going through.
It does.
And then the next step, though, is a very much an internal process.
Yes.
That often you have coached people through helping them understanding what is their brand. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I think that so few of us spend much time introspecting. Mm. We might talk about the fact that we like this, we like that, we like the other thing, but who are we is something that really defines how we'll be doing in this world. Let me give you an example. When I work with somebody and I say, tell me about yourself, they always say to me, well, this is what I've done. It's kind of like this, I've said this before to you, this chronological obituary. You know, I did this and I did that, then I did the next thing. No, tell me about yourself.
Yeah.
Who are you?
Yeah.
Because if I'm going to engage you, either to work with you as a colleague, as we do, or to hire you, who you are is probably even more important than what you've done.
Yeah.
Are you somebody who has the eye for the future? Mm. Are you willing to dig in and do what it takes to get there? All of those questions are about who. We use several different internal assessments, some of which you all may have heard of. One is the Berkman, which is one of my favorite because it's rather deep. You can get people into long conversations, Myers-Briggs and others. But it does require working with a coach so that you can articulate this. And from that comes the front end of your brand. meaning who am I, then what am I going to do?
Yeah.
It's that marriage between those two that makes a brand.
Yeah, it's a mapping process in a way where you're taking the internal desires and approach, and you're mapping it to the external world, which is now what the market trends are about. And that's really step three. Step three is now, what are the market trends in jobs? What are the market trends in working? How are we going to live into our 90s and still have enough income to support ourselves in an ever-increasing expenses world?
Yeah, so it's about income, but it's also about other things. It's that something inside of you that says, I'm still worthwhile, I still have something to contribute. Wow. And I promise you, as time goes by, for most people, that becomes as important as the finances. Nobody wants me, nobody needs me, nobody loves me. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
You can't have a dog and a cat and call it good.
Yeah.
You've got to be that person, that good. So the market analysis, the front end of market study, is really exploration. So this third step, if you would, from letting go into the internal analysis to looking at the market, go explore. Yeah. Have some fun. Just look and see what's going on. Pay attention to when you hear things in the market. Oh, retail's changing. Oh, hotel management's changing. Oh, did you hear that at the X hotel, we have robots delivering room service? All of those are clues to paying attention to what's coming. So step three is really that exploration.
So we talked about longer lifetimes, we talked about technology. What about big data in this? What does that mean?
Oh, that's my most fascinating. I was telling Jay earlier about my hero in big data. I hope he watches this. His name is Bill Schmarzo, and with a name like that, you'd better be a hero, because that's a name to overcome, it truly is. But he, in the U.S., he's probably one of the most revered analytics. He has wonderful books. You can look them up if you're interested. And what he's saying about big data that people have to pay attention to, the day will come, and it's here for many, many, many firms, especially the high-tech firms, where they analyze with data analytics, who I need, when I need them, how long I need them, and even if I need them. And it's not a question that you and I get along, and I've been your boss for 20 years, so we're going to stay.
Yeah.
It's a question of who does the organization need. And frankly, in a world that's competitive, you've got to pay attention to the data. Bill Schmarzo, S-C-H-M-A-R-Z-O, if you want to read, if you can read that stuff and stand it, frankly.
So assuming that now as a person who's looking for a new career or a new job or a new workplace to work, a new pathway to work, maybe even multiple pathways to work, what are the hot opportunities out there? Do you have any, you know, where do you see, you know, doors opening as opposed to pathways narrowing?
Well, I think doors are opening in most fields, but they just don't look like the door that's closing. So if you're talking about, go back to something simple, look at retail.
Okay.
Or look at banking.
Yeah.
Even clearer. I was at the bank this morning. I actually bank on the mainland. I haven't been inside my bank in 20 years.
Wow.
Because you don't need to go into the, it doesn't mean we don't need financial help.
Right.
But do you need all those tellers sitting around all the time?
Yeah.
If so, which ones?
Yeah.
For what reasons?
Yeah.
So each field, what's hot, what's not, has that question and that answer. If I'm looking at engineering, which engineering fields are going to be very, very exciting? Well, most, but which parts, which subsets of the engineering field?
Yeah, for example, resilience of cities is a really big part of the future. How do we prepare cities for climate change? And engineering is an intimate part of that because we have to sometimes protect our cities from these forces.
That's right. Well, I want to continue this discussion. Let's take a short break, shall we?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Carol Cox. I'm the new host of Eyes on Hawaii. Make sure you stay in the know on Hawaii. Join us on Tuesdays at 12 noon. We will see you then. Aloha.
Aloha. I'm Kaui Lucas, host of Hawaii Is My Mainland every Friday at 3 p.m. on ThinkTech Hawaii. We talk about things of interest to those of us who live here, and my past blogs can be found at kauilucas.com. Okay, I didn't listen.
I can't wait to talk more about the strategic planning process. And before we go on, just for 30 seconds, this is not difficult, but it is time consuming. Mm. And we spend more time on our Christmas holiday plans than we do on our own careers. And that's factual. And I do have the data for all of that.
Wow.
So I'm asking everyone to say, stop a minute, think about your future, and put a process in place to get you there. So where are we now?
Well, we're on step five, actually, and exploring our options. So we've done an internal analysis, we've done a market analysis, and now we're taking all of that data and we're putting it together and we're saying, what are our options that are specific to us?
So a challenge says, well, I need to learn a little more technology here. A barrier is, I need to speak Chinese by Wednesday.
No.
That's not going to happen,
okay?
Even with Babbel and all the other translation tools.
Yeah.
So you have to look at it in the sense that if it's a challenge, I can go to school, I can take a class, I can work with somebody in that area for free for a while to get it going back to the portfolio. If it's a barrier, the likelihood of your being able to achieve that is slim to none.
Yeah, okay. So you would do a SWOT analysis in that step, in-depth SWOT analysis for the person, for the organization, or for the group, in order to identify the challenges and barriers.
Do you remember my saying that it's your career is running your business?
Yes.
When I had a business,
yeah.
SWOT analysis is something I did every few months.
Yeah.
Where are we?
It's a continuing process.
The process that you're always looking at, what do I still need? Where's my strength?
I see.
What do I have to overcome?
Yeah.
Who else do I need on the team?
I see.
And we talked about that.
Yes.
That's why we want some of the college students actually on our team.
Yeah. So all college students out there, if you're interested in what we're saying, contact us and we could use a few interested and enthusiastic people. So step seven now is making your plan. So we've done with the strategy, now you make a plan, and then of course you take action. That's the general three-step approach. So what are the metrics that a plan has to have?
I call it SMART planning, and if you look it up on the internet, SMART, specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, time-framed.
Oh, that's a great one.
So action-oriented in there for A.
Sure.
It has to be, this is where the experienced coach comes in.
I see.
Because I'm going to hold your foot to the fire.
Ah, so your accountability.
So you're accountable when you sit there and say, well, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. And then you run off and do something else.
And say, have you done these things?
And what are you doing it by?
I see.
So the SMART planning, it's not difficult, but it really needs somebody to sit on your shoulder.
And that's what a coach is. A coach is really not just a reflective device. A coach is also an active device, the active listening, by listening to what you want to do and then speaking that truth, your truth, and then holding you accountable to that.
Yeah. So. And I think that I can't begin to tell you, when I did this, I wrote this, copyrighted this 10 years ago.
Oh, wow.
I've used it with probably 1,000 people, maybe more. All of them will tell you it's the smartest thing they ever did when they started to learn to treat their career as their business. And then finally, the funny thing about the last step are the marketing tools.
Yeah.
And everybody talks to me about networking. I don't use the term networking. I use the term marketing, because that's all marketing, isn't it?
Yeah, it's inclusive of these other tools. Networking is just one tool.
But when you choose your path, you have different tools.
Yeah.
So we used to just have a resume and a cover letter.
Yeah.
I think the resume will be gone in 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
If you don't have a LinkedIn today,
Yeah.
If you don't have specific tools
yeah.
for the area you're pursuing, yeah. you're going to lose opportunities.
But the tools are last. The tools, the development
last.
Tools are last because they're now toned and specific to your plan.
That's right.
To your strategies, not just, oh, this is a general tool, use it everywhere.
That's the point.
Yeah.
So when we met with the college students, say, oh, I wanted the tools.
Yeah.
And I said, well, wait a minute.
Yeah.
What's your strategy?
Who are you? What's your strategy? What's your plan?
And then yeah. we do tools at the end of that. Yeah. So we're kind of coming close on, I think, here. I know there were a couple things we wanted to just add before we got off the air, so to speak. What's so different about New Workforce Hawaii? Give me a few of the differentiators.
Well, I think that we help guide people through these turbulent waters, and change is happening so rapidly, many people don't have those tools, and they don't have the process, and they don't understand what's going on. And all of a sudden, they find themselves out of work, and how do I cope? Oh, I go into depression, or I go find a resume coach, or I go online and I search, and I frantically apply for as many jobs as I can. And what New Workforce Hawaii does is we help you have a targeted, specific, strategic plan of action that you can move forward into your new future.
Well, and I think that some of the differentiators, we work with older workers,
yeah.
and I do mean older, 60, 65, 70, that's okay with me, two. We work with the youngest workers. I'm on the board of Star of the Sea. I've told you that before.
Yeah.
And we're doing robotics and stuff with third graders. And I mean, it's important for them to start seeing things differently.
Yeah.
So basically, there's so many differentiators. I could give you 10. And if you ask us back again one day, I'll give you the 10. How's that?
Yeah. Thank you. Are we done?
I think we're just about at the end. Yes, thank you so much for
joining
us.
Can we talk about our book a little bit? Maybe show the image of our book cover? Do we have enough time for that? Yeah, so tell me about what started this book.
Okay, so this is the freebie book.
Yeah.
This is the book that you can get online at newworkforcehawaii.com
by
downloading online. It's short. The book that's coming is very thorough about all the ways there are to work and how, not just what, how to do it.
Yeah. Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, this has been New Workforce Hawaii, and we really appreciate you listening, and we hope that you're as excited about your career as we are about helping you. Thank you.
Thank you.